So to summarize the 1094C, there are four parts to this. Depending on your specifics, you may not have to complete all four parts. But in essence, part one is demographic information. Again, this is specific to you as an employer that you complete this. Part two is where you're going to make selections of some options that you have available as far as how you're managing the group of employees. If in fact you're an aggregate employer, which Caroline will speak to here in a little bit. Part three is where we're going to record the number of full-time employees we had every month. That is where they test us on the large penalty, 49AHA penalty. This is how they determined if we're at risk for penalties there. We spent a bunch of time going through that specifically. What you'll find here, one of the challenges you have is where do I collect the information that goes into these forms? Very difficult to find one vendor that's going to have all this information, especially if it's stuff that you're having to sign on a local basis. So I'm having to grab information from different resources. I think you'll see as I go through this, payroll many times will not be the best resource for some of this, including the information you're going to need for this form. One thing I always like to point out, if you are not the ultimate decision maker at your employment and you're struggling to get the resources that you need in order to make sure you can do this, there is a section at the bottom of this form. Somebody's got to sign this. When it goes to the IRS under penalty of perjury, I test the information is accurate, blah, blah. So in essence, you don't have what you need, go get this to the person that's going to have to sign it and say, hey, our department doesn't have what we need to do this correctly. You're going to have to sign off on this and say that you test that it is. Certainly don't want to be in the jail cell and tell somebody in there because they didn't perform my 1094C correctly. Probably going to have some issues there.
Yeah.
1094C Part 1, applicable large employee information. Very similar to the 1094C, as I stated. Just complete the lines. You will see on line 7, 8, you are going to have to put the contact person here. So on the 1095C, we're listing the individual for the employees to call if they have questions when they get the form. The IRS has stated this, make sure it's somebody that can answer those questions. For the 1094C, it's who's the individual when the IRS calls that's going to have the information to be able to talk knowledgeably about the 1094C. Why did you put this? What's the answer here? So just understand. Again, whoever that individual is, they're on the list. 9 through 16 is a visiting governmental entity. If you're fortunate enough that you've got, hey, I'm the municipality and this other sector, this other entity within our government is going to do the filings for us. I've not run across a single person yet that's going to do that. Sometimes you'll see with a, actually nobody's doing this yet. It happened to be on a state health plan and the state said we're going to file for you. None of the states have said that. They don't want liability. So don't expect, well, anybody's going to have a DG, designated governmental entity. Line 18, you're going to put the total number of 1095Cs that you're filing with your 1094C. So how many of the individual written statements are included with this filing for the 1094C? So that's what I'm going to put on that form, that line. Box 19 is if we're the authoritative transmittal. So kind of think of this, and we'll talk more in detail, but I've got three entities, three tax ID numbers, we're all one employer. We've made the decision we're one employer. Maybe it's the city, but I've got police and fire, and I've got the highway department. We think we're one entity. Depending on the different tax ID numbers, I might be filing separate 1094Cs, but one's got to be the authoritative. Who's the mothership? So that's got to indicate we're the mothership for these other entities that fall underneath us. So I'll check that box to indicate to the IRS we're the mothership. If it's a private employer, same thing. We own, you know, MedBen owns several other entities. Maybe MedBen, whatever, is the mothership. They'll check that they're authoritative transmittal. The other entities will not check that box. They're all parts of underneath the umbrella head company. All right, part two. This is where we're going to put additional information specific to decisions that you've made. Are we an aggregated employer? Do we have multiple employers underneath us? What are some certifications that we can choose as far as how we're filing these forms? If we're eligible for one of the qualifying offers, Specific to line 20, this is going to be the total number of 1095Cs that were filed on behalf of that employer. So if you're the authoritative transmittal, you're going to put how many you filed, and let's say we've got multiple 1094s. I put how many I filed with my filing, as well as how many are under the umbrella altogether. If I'm one of the entities that's not the authoritative transmittal, they're just going to put the total number. It'll be the same for lines 18 and 20. If I'm only one employer, 18 and 20 is going to be the same as well. How many 1095Cs we filed. If we're members of an aggregated group, I will notify that. I'm going to check that. Caroline, let's do that now if you might want to kind of talk to that. There's a sheet in your folder. It's a one pager front and back. We've kind of outlined the aggregate employer flow chart to try to help you all make a determination if, in fact, you are part of another group.
Okay, so this is going to be different for private employers or for-profit employers versus governmental entities versus nonprofit employers. So we're going to start at the beginning. If you are a for-profit or a private employer, you need to look to determine whether or not you have multiple applicable large employers or other entities under your umbrella entity. The first place to usually look is if you have multiple tax ID numbers, or you do business under multiple tax ID numbers. There could be different divisions. Those could actually be separate taxable entities. If, in fact, the group of entities collected together meet the requirements of the IRS code for a control group, sometimes we call that common ownership, then all of those employers aggregated together must file and would be considered a large employer. So if I have two tax ID numbers, two separate entities, two corporate private employers, both with employees, one has 75 employees and one has 15 employees. Because they're aggregated together under these IRS rules, it's IRS code section 414, and there are multiple ways delineated under that section to determine whether or not you are to be aggregated together. But in many times it's a facts and circumstances test. So it's not something that MedBen could say, oh yes, you've got multiple entities, so you're definitely an aggregated control group. But if you did in that situation where there were 75 employees in one company and 15 in another, the 15 life employer is going to be considered a large employer for healthcare reform purposes because they're aggregated with the 75 life group, and together they're considered a large employer, which means not just for reporting purposes, but for all other purposes under healthcare reform, that's a large employer. You're subject to penalties then and need to file the 1095C as well. The facts and circumstances tests are complicated. I can tell you that generally speaking, if you have one corporate entity that owns 100% of the other corporate entities, you're probably going to be a control group. If you have one corporate entity that owns 15% of one entity and 25% of another and 50% of another, then that gets into some pretty difficult calculations with regards to the IRS. I can tell you that this isn't a determination you want to make just based on what you think or based on healthcare reform purposes. Like, it'd be nice if we were an aggregated ALE because then I only have to do one form. Because that's a determination that you're going to be certifying, as Mike said, signing the 1094C, that you are an aggregated ALE, that you have multiple applicable large employers to the IRS. And your tax people or attorneys may have made this decision based on other facts and circumstances. This isn't just a rule that applies to this. It applies to any of your businesses for tax purposes. And so you want to make sure that that determination has been made and that you know what the answer is before you jump into the 1094C. If you're not for profit, if you have multiple agencies with multiple tax ID numbers under one umbrella, you really need to talk to your attorney or your tax accountant because you want to make sure that you know how you're filing. The law, from an ACA perspective, says that you're reporting and you're making a good faith effort to sort of combine in a way that is reasonable for ACA purposes, then that is sufficient for this. But again, that determination may have been made for you for other reasons, other tax purposes, other tax filings. If you're a governmental entity, then you do use a reasonable method to determine whether or not you are combined for ALE purposes. So we have a client in Kentucky. In Kentucky, they call them fiscal districts, and there is fire and police and counties and cities and trustees, and then they're all together and they're in one plan. And in Kentucky, you're allowed to do that. You're allowed to consolidate and put all these entities together for one purpose. So it may be that even though some of these fire districts in and of themselves are very small and would be considered small employers, it may be that that entity together has decided, hey, we're going to consider ourselves large, we're going to make a plan together, we've been consolidated for plan purposes. Because we're consolidated for plan purposes, I'm going to use that sort of as my reasonableness standard to decide that I'm going to file as an aggregated ALE. And Mike's going to get to show that you're going to have to then list each of those independent members with each of their tax ID numbers, but you'll be aggregated together for purposes of filing. In Ohio, we have a law that allows counties and schools and municipalities to form consortiums together. It may be that that school's consortium had decided that they're going to be an applicable large employer, even though it's an aggregate or a consortium of a lot of smaller school districts that have less than 50 employees total. That decision has to be made sort of independently. I can tell you in Ohio, I've had multiple conversations with the state auditor's office on a regular basis, and they don't really know what to do either. They're still in the, I'm confused and I don't know why the feds are telling us what to do at the state level. That's probably the way they feel in multiple states. Mike has more experience in other states with other public employers, but in Ohio, that's where we are. And they haven't said, you have to do one thing or the other, which actually gives you a little bit more flexibility if you're a public employer to sort of do what you think you need to do, what makes most sense to you. Again, if you've got you're a government entity and you've got these entities combined under one plan, I think that's a pretty good reasonableness standard to say we're going to file together. It's certainly going to be easier for you as a plan administrator to do that. It's going to be easier on those entities as well to not have to file separately. But then Mike will show you in the form where you get to when you have to identify these members. So if you are part of a control group or have common ownership, you have to delineate each of the members that you're reporting on your 1094C. Questions? Confusion? There is a handout, I think, in that. I think we have some IRS guidance on control group status if you're a private employer. It's fascinating reading. There's also 5 points provided. There's a little decision tool here that'll help you sort of walk through some of those issues as well.
And obviously, you need to use your general counsel to get comfortable here. Again, for-profit company, it's facts and circumstances testing, very, very easy. Not easy, but the concrete way to determine that. Unfortunately, if you're a non-for-profit government, it is more difficult until they have a reasonable method based on the auditor, their definition of reasonable. And then in Tennessee, you get the Department of Sheriff's that's offering guidance on the federal law, too.
Very helpful.
Yeah. If you're not the authoritative transmittal, you do not complete column B of the part three, and you don't do part four either. We'll show you that. Part two is certification of eligibility. These are decisions you're going to make on a local basis. Specifically, you've got 4 options there. Depending on the next section I go through, you may think, hey, this is easy, I'm going to pick this qualifying offer. I get to omit certain lines or columns in the next reporting. But there are caveats to these. I have to certify that offer benefits 98% of my full-time employees. As I identify that more correctly, what a full-time employee may decide, okay, I don't think we can pass that. Some of the simplification reporting things says, hey, we're doing the 1095C for our individual employees. I have to send that to the IRS. But one of the simplified options says, if I check this box, then I get to use a simplified report instead of to send out to my employees. I don't have to send them 1095C. So help me understand how it's simplified. I'm already producing 1095C for my employees. Why would I produce a wholly separate simplified form, a separate form to send to my employees when I can already sign up to 1095C. So the IRS's definition of simplification, I think, is a little wacky. Absolutely, code C, every single person here wants to check box C, which is the transition rule this year for 2015. I'll go through that in detail. So what that is, if you don't have anybody in here below 100, if you're below 100, we bought another year for the employer mandate. As long as we elect this option, we don't have employer penalties. We still have to do the IRS form filing, but we don't have penalties for, again, for 2015. As long as I elect this option. If I'm over 100 employees, I get the 70% rule, which I'm going to go through instead of the 95% rule. Unless I don't elect this, and I'm at the 95% rule for 2015.
What if you're under 50 and self-insured, and you still have to fill out this form, correct?
You still have to complete the form. You don't have the transition rules because I'm not at risk for penalties anyways. Yeah. This just gives, this buys me at 50 to 99 if I get to avoid the penalties. Yeah. So you are going to check, everybody checks box C. Why they didn't default to that, who the heck knows. So instead of the 95% rule, I get to use the 70% rule. And then instead of throwing 30 employees away, which I'll explain more, I get to throw 80 away this year. So it's certainly a significant opportunity for you.